least once a month I go to a lecture, but this is the first time I get to give the lecture, so it's pretty nice. I'm Graeme Whifler. My father was William Whifler. So that's my dad, a little kid there at the beach. He's about 3 years old. I don't know what beach that is. Might be San Mateo. And I don't know who the woman is. And that's the house at Drake Street. It was a German family that came from New York. My dad there, he's learning how to drive. He just got his permit in California. He became a pretty good driver. Anyway, so that's the old house. And the new house that I'll be showing you later, the one that's on the register, is right next to it. This is the house he grew up in. And it was a Craftsman bungalow. It was just a beautiful, gorgeous house with gardens all around it. And there he is a little bit later with his father and his mother and his grandmother. And I just had this footage transferred. And it looks like it was shot yesterday. There it is. Okay, and I'll be showing you a picture of this. This is the dead end. This is the dead end of Drake.
Into the park.
And we'll be coming back to this for a second. Okay, and then he meets my mom. And it's World War II. He's in the Navy. He's teaching electronics in Treasure Island. And there they are. My grandmother. And they met at Burlingame High School, and there they are. They're going steady, and one thing leads to another, and they get married, and there's the old-fashioned wedding video. And of course, no date. And honeymoon bound.
Oh, yeah.
So then this is a mid-century modern tree. This is the house that I grew up in. John Schrock designed the tree. That's my little brother Dan. That's me. That's the fireplace. It's Christmas. And I shortened these down way down because it was like an hour of just one Christmas after another. And we're opening presents. And the artwork on the right, my dad did the artwork on the right. Lots of artwork. And we had cats. And you couldn't go to bed without a cat. And this is the last shot of my dad. I took this one. So, those are the family videos. Now, I'm going to show you that shot because I got something to say about this one. Okay, so, end of the street, 1544 Drake is right here. And back here, that's an old dairy farm. Yeah. And my dad would go out there with his .22 rifle and plink around. And the owners of the dairy farm really didn't notice them much. They had a little house that they stayed in, and that's their house. It was a Mills estate. That was the Mills estate. He was right up against the Mills estate. His houses have a kind of a Japanese feel to them, and which I don't, there are no pictures in existence, nothing in the historical record, but over here, right across the street, there was a traditional, perfectly done Japanese house. No windows, screens throughout, no nails, just wood, pegs, and for some reason, World War II and the Japanese stuff went out of fashion, so it got torn down and they put a ranch house there. And then, you would look at that, and that definitely had an influence on his work. Definitely had an influence on his work. And then off to the side here, this is the formal garden of the house that he grew up in. And there he is in the fish pond at the house. You can see the house in the background there in the fish pond. Now, what he didn't know, being a kid and all, was that in 30 years, his grandmother or his mother would be sitting there with a reporter in the new house that he had designed for her. And the little fish pond is right off over here. There's another shot of the house, and the fish pond is still there. It's incorporated into, it's right about here. And this is here, it's 1544 Drake. So his mother was an actress when she was young, in her teens and early 20s, before they moved out to Burlington. They came around 1924. And these are some pictures of her acting. And that's what the house looked like. You can't see much of it because there were gardens everywhere, all around the house. And there is the screen porch and a swing, and that's the interior of the house. Traditional craftsman. Now, my dad got a taste of what was to come. Because at some point, somebody in the house said, well, this craftsman stuff's too old. So they went and they painted all the woodwork white, and they tore out the fireplace and put in a nice little Spanish, because they thought Spanish style was better. So they did Spanish style on the inside, but they didn't bother with the outside. Oh, and this, because this is adults only, I can share this. This happened to my grandmother. It was in three newspapers. She was taking a bath, and a snake came through the pipes. And I can't read it, but the writer had a great, all three writers had a great fun with it. They were, it was big tongue in cheek. But the last article there, the very bottom, they said, oh, and by the way, the young matron was an actress. Now I'm thinking somebody had a press agent, and that was a setup, you know, because when you think about it, how many snakes ever come through a pipe into a bathroom where there's a young naked actress? You know? And this was his dad. He was kind of a stern guy. He got gassed in the First World War. He had very, very bad lungs. He was not a well person. And this is his baby album from 26. And mother was an actress, so she had him dress up in costumes. And there he is, a young man. And this is his room. Now, this is interesting, because this is the gun he would terrorize the mills with. I still have these snowshoes in my house. And this here is real important. He was into radio. He was a ham radio guy. He loved radio. He had a left brain, right brain that just wouldn't stop. And in his houses, he did his own engineering. Anyway. So there they are. But this is a scary picture. This is the only one they had in high school, and they look like they're in a gang or something. I mean, they really look threatening. And it's completely not who they are, but you know, it's a high school. Let me take your picture, okay? So anyway, they got together, the two mothers, and they're smiling, and everyone's happy, and they're no longer in high school here. So this is this shot just before they get married. And they've lost that high school toughness. Okay, so they're getting married. And my dad's got his first apprenticeship with a guy named Oscar Mayer. And he did a lot of houses with Oscar. And Oscar would kind of give him a free hand. Most of those houses, they were all in Estelle, had been torn down. Very few exist. And here in the paper, Oscar and him have done a proposal for an indoor pool for Washington Park. But they had to raise $250,000, and the people of Burlingame didn't want to spend the money, so that went nowhere. Okay, this is where I grew up. Well, I didn't grow up in the woods, but I'm about 1 year old, they want to build a house somewhere. They wanted to get a dead-end street. My dad grew up on a dead-end street. Dead-end streets were safer so the kids don't get run over. They don't have very much money. So they find this lot. And it's up on the top of Hillsborough near Black Mountain Road. And it's an acre, but it's $5,000. And they don't have $5,000. And so he begs his mother, and she says, hell no, that's way up there. No one's going to go up there. And that's out in the middle of nowhere. Somehow they scrape up the money, they buy the land, and the first thing they do, they have to sell half of it, a half acre, to get $2,500 back, because they can't afford it. And so they sell it to the neighbor, they become friends with the neighbor. Neighbor builds a house, and what does my dad give him for a housewarming present? What does an architect give somebody for a housewarming present?
House plans.
3 yards of ready mixed concrete in the truck. and this is the house being built. It was a very small house, still there today. I've seen some of the receipts for it, and you know, it's like $5 here, 35 cents here. It was cheap to build by today's standards. And he did a lot of the work himself. He did more of the house. Oh, and I forgot. One of the most important things, see those eucalyptus trees? Mm-hmm. That was eucalyptus forest. Why was it eucalyptus forest? Was abandoned for it was actually a grove of planted eucalyptus, and they were used for oyster poles down in San Francisco Bay, you know, Oyster Point. So what they do is they get eucalyptus trees, and these are they've already abandoned it, so they're way too tall, but they grow up really fast, so they just come through and cut them down, put the poles in the ocean or in the bay, and then move on. Anyway, so that was abandoned oyster pole. And that's the fireplace, and he started, he did a lot of the masonry work, and that was his first attempt at masonry, and that's kind of the heart of the house. That was just a picture taken inside the house, so I got the fire a little bit too hot. And this is, again, the exterior of the house. Now, you can see the exposed fireplace. In a couple of years, there's going to be a room where that fireplace is. Now, this house has had probably 18 different additions.
Wow.
And it served as a laboratory for him. And because he built a lot of it himself, and he'd try out new techniques. Or if he had a client and he really liked what he did for a client, he'd do a little bit of that at home for himself. This was the first addition. It was a family room stuck on the end of the house. It's hard to see, but this here is an addition. There's a second carpet. I mean, if the thing just grew organically, but what was brilliant about his design was, if you go to it today, you would never, ever know that it had all these additions. They're absolutely seamless. And that's another addition. What he did was, what they did was, every time they had a kid, they had to build a new room. So that was one of the last rooms.
Do you have to have permits back then?
Oh yeah. Everything was done with a permit. Oh yeah. I've seen the permits.
Yeah.
And you can see here where one old thing joins to a new thing, and he wanted to extend it out a little bit. And I'd watch him, he'd work down in the workshop, and I'd watch him cutting these boards, and go, what's that supposed to be for? Because it was just this weird shaped board, and then it was screwed up, and it was an extension. Did a lot of that. And you can see all the different angles in the house as it kind of pieces together. Another room added on. That was at one point my sandbox, and then it became a fish pond. And the planter there, that little triangular planter, he did all the cement work himself. All his stuff he did himself. Now, this is the part where it gets illegal, because he used child labor to dig this pool. me and my brother, and it was like, in one corner it was just like rock. But the fortunate part was we only had to go down about 3 feet because the rest of the pool was built up on concrete blocks. Most of it was concrete blocks. So me and my brother, we learned how to lay concrete blocks. We learned how to pour cement and how, not we weren't really good finishers, but we definitely learned how, before they had cement pumping, we learned how to take the cement in a wheelbarrow and bring it, and dump it. It was cement stuff. But anyway, I learned so much about the building from being with my dad. I mean, we had no choice. Either we worked. Okay, this is kind of interesting. So he built himself a barbecue, indoor barbecue, and. One of the elements he used on the Drake house is the steel. This is a later, this is all an addition. So that was used trying out steel. And the steel wraps around here. Now, this here, he'd gone to, with my mom, in a car trip south. And they'd gone to Arizona. And they'd gone to Tallahassee and West, and that's where he got the idea for that base there. He saw that, and I think I'll try that. So he tried that. And then I remember him he put all the white concrete, white mortar. He did all the mortar work, he let it cure. And then he brought out some black paint, started dripping on it. And I thought he was crazy. He just looked at me and kind of smiled because this was his homage to Richard Pollock, the modern artist. And he did things like a light deck. This is what he called a light deck. Now, again, I was in the basement where he had a tool shop there, or a wood shop. And he was building this thing, but it was right side up, and I had no idea it was going to hang on the ceiling. I couldn't figure out, again, what the hell he was building it. It was like, and then all of a sudden he put it up on the ceiling. Oh, I get it now. So he did a lot of stuff in his wood shop. He did lights. That's a birdhouse that he did. And in his wood shop was an electronics lab. He never gave up electronics. So he'd be down there, you know, that was a time when there were tubes. And he loved doing it. We'd sit down there and listen to Radio Moscow together. It was really spooky because you could tune in at night. But my grandma, his mother, had friends, and everyone's TV would go out because the tubes would go out. So they'd bring them to him to fix. And he'd go, oh, no, another TV. So he'd fix the tube. But the problem is he'd give it back to them, and like 2 or 3 weeks later, they'd say, you didn't do it right because another tube had gone out. So that was. And there's a family.
Aww.
And that's my sister. And this is yours truly, the photographer. And you know that what they say, if you want to take a good picture, you got to dress right. So you got the bolo tie, the perm pressed pants, the whole. That's a picture of the house at night. Interior. Moving on. To the William A. Whifler House. The family worked to get this on the National Register. It was a process. I still say it was a process, but I'm really glad we did. And this is the first picture probably taken of the house, probably 1958. My grandmother's hot DeSoto was in the driveway. Now, she's standing out in front of her house. And he built it for her. It was on this. It was on in the garden, which used to be the garden. They built a house there, partly because they could sell the old house and pocket the money for her retirement, and he really wanted to do something special for his mom. He wanted to show his mom how good he was. And he did this house. This is a funny story. When they were building it, she'd come in late at night and go through all the where the carpenters were, or the carpenter worked, and she had a little sponge and a cloth, and she'd wipe down all their extension cords so they'd have clean extension cords. It's the German in her. So anyway, she's sitting here and she doesn't know. This is a pretty weird house. It's not like what she's used to. I mean, it's definitely different. Huh?
Roughly what year was that?
58.
How fun that we're still painting the curbs with the same addresses.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this is what he built for her. And it was really weird, and she didn't know. And it was, but it got in the newspapers. Okay, so when she started seeing it in the newspapers, then she was happy. Then she'd sit there, read the newspaper, and see her house. And okay, she loved it. So she was sold on mid-century modern at that point. She went out and got a Christmas tree, a mid-century Christmas tree. And she was one hell of a lady. Neighbors told me they would see her out gardening, and she'd be wearing a leopard skin outfit because she's an actress when she was in the garden gardening. And she was one tough old bird too, because there's a flat roof, and into her 80s she would still get on a little step ladder, climb up onto the roof so she could sweep it clean, because she's German and you have to have a clean roof. And that's the family in front of that fireplace. And this is later on, she was very active in the Hillbarn Theater and local theater stuff. And a bunch of times we would go down, the family would go down if there was a parade in Burlingame, because she'd be in it and see her in a car and she'd be waving to us. And the Burlingame Women's Club, she loved the Burlingame Women's Club. And then he did this. Everyone knows that one. Yeah, he started with a guy named Paul Zimmerman. They started the architecture department at College of San Mateo. And it was a real hands-on department. I met and got to know a bunch of his former students, and they just loved it. They just, because it was totally hands-on. There's nothing theoretical about it. They had the design, and it's since been taken out, and everything in College of San Mateo they had to do with actually doing stuff they took away because they wanted to make it a more academic institution. But he was really beloved by his students, and this is one of the drawings from his lectures. It was box, anti-box. This house or that house, which is the one, box or anti-box. So he'd give these really interesting assignments. One, he'd give a topographical plot for a lot, and it would be just the lot with all the shape of the land, and he'd tell the students, okay, design me a house. And so they'd know where the west and the east and the south, all that information. They'd turn in their design, and then he would give them the address of the house that he had designed on that plot, so they could see how somebody else had taken that. And he was really, really, if you look at his house, they're all oriented perfectly to the sun. They're all oriented perfectly for privacy. No curtains allowed. I mean, I learned that growing up. No curtains allowed, ever. And he taught me a lot. He was kind of a mystery. He got me excited with photography, design. Um, One of the things that I learned from him was he used to say that there, if tastes don't vary, it's a matter of degree. And as a kid, there were a couple of times when we'd have to pile in the car and go for a drive, because it was an architectural drive. And one of them would be, there were a lot of new houses being built in the area, and we just go look at the, gawk at the new houses, and he'd go drive by and go, dingbat, dingbat, dingbat. And then if there was one that was good, he'd be quiet. He'd just start staring at it. But that wasn't, there were a few of those. Lots of dingbats. And then the other time was a really rushed trip. And they would go, let's get in the car. And we get in the car because another Eichler had burned. They'd have Eichler fires up at the top of the hill there, Bunker Hill? Eichler, and he had done the same kind of design, which was 3/4 inch ply, 1/4 inch Luan mahogany over studs, with no, which they require now, no sheetrock. So the fire department couldn't even get there. I mean, by the time the fire department got, it was just ashes. And that really, that kind of spooked them. And if there was ever a building, it was a school that had collapsed, they're building it down in Alameda. We had to go and look at the collapsed school, because there was a lesson there in engineering. And what had failed? He did his own, a lot of his own engineering. So, incredible guy. And I got, we've got time, so I'm going to show you two more houses. And it's the same owner. And these people had him design one for them. It was one of the first houses that I went to. I was probably about 3 years old. I remember walking through. My childhood, I would go to all the job sites. The smell, I can remember the smell of concrete and the freshly churned soil from when they'd come in and done all the excavation work. So this one was for a couple named the McMakins, and he did this one. This was one of his first, and I think this is about 50, mid-50s. And this was a shot. It was the first time he got into a magazine. He was a shy guy, and he suffered from it. He took his own pictures. He didn't, I don't know if he took this one or not. He did a lot of his own photography, but he should have done more. Actually, what they say is every architect needs a great photographer. Photographer is the most important thing for an architect. And this was his first bit of publicity, and he didn't get a lot more. I mean, he got some from his mom's house, but anyway, this is the interior of it. This is the way it looked several years ago. Yeah, it's a nice, modest little house. Again, it incorporates all his stuff, where it's all oriented correctly to the sun. It's completely private. And then they had him do this house. And this is on Hain in Hillsboro. And it's kind of it looks like it's from Wright. I don't know where he got that idea, but I'm just gonna show you these. The woodwork on the inside was just amazing. And he did call it a polished concrete floors, just like Wright did. In the house I grew up in, him and my mom polished the floors. And oh my God, it was hard. They were my mom was complaining. They were on their hands and knees with wax polishing floor. Anyway, kitchen. Indoor barbecue. More shots of the house. I don't know who she is, but she may be here tonight. And that's the. I came back The house was on the market as a teardown. And so I came back to capture what I could, document it, and I'll show you. Well, they had a meeting for the teardown, and the biggest advocate for tearing it down was one of his students. Oh, yeah. It's funny how this thing happened. Anyway, so, but it was, and it didn't actually get torn down. It got, let's just say, improved. They put a second story on it, and somebody glued marble all over the outside. And always with his houses, you know, the carpenters, when it got down to finish time, oh my God, it was, they'd be pulling their hair, because everything was hand done, and it was really intricate woodwork and finish work, which is not done anymore. Yeah. Trees went right through it. And that's it. Wow.